Mr. Taru, back again. We're going to start discussing in statistics about how to collect or create or just get some data to actually analyze. We've been making pie charts and histograms and dot plots and stem plots and pick a graph. But we've been doing all this analysis of data but have not yet discussed how this data comes about. How do we collect it? How do we create it through experiments? And I always talk to my kids about saving money in high school as teenagers for retirement because, you take that compound interest and you let it roll 30, 40, 50 years. Well, not 30, but if your retirement age is 65, you start saving when you're 16, you got almost 50 years for compound interest to roll up, you can actually have a pretty nice retirement and not have to stress about it too much. So I end up, for my birthday, I got a $100 bill t-shirt, so Funny Shirt Friday. Anyway, that's why I'm wearing this shirt. Okay, two basic ways of collecting data. There's the observational study, where you observe individuals and measurements, but you are not imposing a treatment. Key phrase right here. So, let's take the scenario of, again, talking about smoking and causing lung cancer. You can't take 1,000 people and randomly assign them into two groups where one group just is forced to smoke, the other group is prevented from smoking, and oh, by the way, not only is that already unethical, but you're going to have to all eat the same foods, live in the same houses, do the same job, exercise the same. You know, every facet of your life is going to be identical except for, oh, by the way, you 500 smoke and you don't. So in situations where it's impossible to run an experiment, or, isn't necessary, you're looking at an observational study, any scenario where you're not imposing a treatment. Now, what if you do impose a treatment? Well, then you're setting up an experiment. You impose a treatment on individuals or subjects, if they're humans, in order to observe their responses. Maybe you want to find out if a new cholesterol drug helps to lower cholesterol better than an old drug. Okay, take some people with high cholesterol, randomly assign them to two groups. We'll talk about how to do that later. And one group gets the old drug, the control, not a placebo like sugar pill, because high cholesterol could be very bad for your health. So maybe an old drug, and then the treatment group gets a new drug, and then you will later discuss how you compare those numbers to see if the new drug was truly effective. So any scenario where you're imposing a treatment would be an experiment. And experiments are the easiest way to prove cause and effect. Observational studies alone supposedly cannot prove cause and effect. I'm sure there's some scenario where somebody might be able to argue that a tiny bit. But cause and effect, and especially in life, is a very, very complicated and difficult thing to prove. You need to have a strong correlation or association. You need to have that association be consistent. We talked about with smoking about how it doesn't matter what country you're in, the more you smoke, the more chance you have of getting lung cancer. That the more explanatory variable, the stronger the response, that the cause precedes the effect, and that it's plausible. There's five key things to look for to show evidence for causation. And observations alone are very basically not appropriate for proving cause and effect. A well-done sample will produce a group of individuals that will unbiasedly represent the entire population, the entire group of individuals we want information about. So if I wanted a survey of the school about how they feel about the teachers here, then I could just go down to guidance. I could get a list of all the students and randomly just pull numbers out of a hat and say, go randomly choose 50 students. So the population would be all the students at the school. If I only wanted to survey the seniors, then same thing. Go down and get a list of all the seniors, randomly select maybe 100 of them or 50 or who knows, whatever you feel like is appropriate. And the population would be just the seniors of this particular high school. So the population, by definition, is all of the individuals, but not like everybody in the world. It's everybody that, or everything that you want to learn about or represent in your experiment or in your observational study or your survey. If I do a survey of just my school about a topic, it could not therefore be then sort of imposed or summarized or inferenced for the entire county or state. Not if I just pulled students from my own school. So the population is the entire group of individuals we want information about. And a sample would need to represent that particular population you are trying to learn about. So if I want to an opinion about just the seniors in our school, I'll randomly select just some seniors as an example. Okay, moving on.
No.
Involves part of a population to learn about the whole population, very often the best option. Let's go back to that survey in the entire school. Would I want to actually attempt to contact all 400 students that come to the school? That would be very time consuming and unnecessary. I could just sample about 100 and get a very good idea about what the entire school feels about whatever I'm talking about. If I want to see what new cholesterol drug works better, or if a new cholesterol drug works better than an old cholesterol drug, I can't run an experiment on every single person that has high cholesterol. No, I would just go take a random sampling of people with high cholesterol. If, and think of like your country or your state, probably just a country government wanting to run a census, how hard it is to contact everybody or everything in an entire population. So we normally just work with sampling and then try and inference the results from the sample to the entire population. The definition of inference is using a sample's results to make a conclusion about the entire population. We're not too really doing that step yet. We're just collecting numbers, so I'm going to leave that vocab, this word there at that. A census attempts to contact every individual in a population. These are very expensive, very time-consuming, and very, very often not possible. And also, if you're trying to work with every subject or unit in an entire population, you will very quickly be overwhelmed by a mass of data, which will actually probably lead to more errors than just you would get from a sample. Okay, now we're going to talk about two sampling methods, and I don't think I have an issue with time, but I definitely have an issue with space. This video is going to be a multi-part video so that I can get all these sampling and experimental designs set up for you. Today is just sampling. Voluntary response. Sampling consists of people who choose themselves to be in the general survey. Think of radio call-in surveys, TV or internet surveys. These are most certainly negatively biased since we find it easier to complain than to compliment, even about ourselves. With my students, if I ask them what they like or dislike about themselves and give them just a short period of time to come up with some answers, maybe a minute or less even, the list of complaints about even about themselves would grow very quickly, especially compared to what they were going to say they like about themselves. Just, you know, when we're unhappy, we complain, we voice out, and not often enough compliment people or point out what things are good. If you're happy, you're kind of content and satisfied and just sort of, you know, chill. So all these, you know, go to the internet and click on what do you think, you know, what you feel about, or hey, this is some kind of TV, maybe I'm conservative, maybe I'm liberal, and I'm this is a show, hey, why don't you get on the internet and give us an opinion about what you think is going on in politics or the economy or just whatever you feel like. The radio station, hey, call us in and tell us what you think about so-and-so that happened this weekend. All of those surveys are so common and they're almost always negatively biased. You get something to talk about, but there's no real validity behind those results. It's always going to be negatively biased. It's going to be more people complaining that are unhappy about what's going on, and those individuals in the population will be overrepresented in a voluntary response, giving you what is known as a negatively biased survey. Woo! All right!
No.
Coming in on the left. Woo! All right, last not-so-great sampling method that we have in Intro to Statistics. That's convenient sampling. Convenient sampling is surveying those people who are easiest to reach, close by. You know, you're not really doing any real hard work to get to these people. It's not random selection. You're not trying to contact them by phone or email. through some randomization process. You just, well, what did I talk about? Interviewing shoppers just by going to the mall and talking to whoever walks by. This may be okay if you want to report the habits for the shoppers of that mall, but could not be applied to all shoppers. Let's say that you do have a shopping mall, or you do have a store, and you want to find out how you could improve that store. Well, if all you do is stand at your door and go, hey, are you happy? Well, you certainly will get some negative comments. And again, you're trying to randomly select these people as they come in, or maybe you're just, well, actually, no, you're just standing at the door and they just happen to walk in. Hey, you like our store? You like what we're doing? Well, wouldn't the people coming to the store already be happy with what you're doing? You might get a false hope that what you're doing, or a false conclusion that what you're doing, the way your store is set up, the prices, whatever, that they're all fine. But what about all those people that are not coming to your store? Like, if you find out from your shoppers if you're doing well or not doing well, certainly it's probably has some validity, but if you really want to pull in a lot more business, why not find out what all those people not coming to your store? Why aren't they coming? Are the prices too high? Is it not set up well? Just one example, of course. But convenience sampling is just kind of chilling out. Whoever walks by, you kind of just survey them and see what's going on. That's not a good sampling technique. The convenience sampling and the voluntary response, they take little to work for the collector of the data, but you will not get results that are very useful or just not useful at all. Again, with the voluntary response, you're going to have negative bias. With the convenience sampling, it'll be nearly impossible for you to get a sample that truly represents the population that you would like to learn about. So you do not want to do these type of sampling techniques. We have to teach them, because if you don't know how to do things wrong, you might not understand what's good about what is right. So let's get this erased. Give me some time to copy a new set of notes up here. Of course, all you're going to do is hit play on the next video. Thank you for watching. I do greatly appreciate it. Like me, subscribe to me, click on an ad if it looks interesting. And thank you very much for watching.